some numbers here.
Oh, that's the last page instead.
Oh, okay.
Okay, what's on the electronic document? Okay, good.
We good? Colleen, Jean, we good? Tracy, we good? Okay. Good evening. We'll call the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners meeting to order. Start out with my introductory statement. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners is being broadcast live at the RMLD office here at 230 Ash Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. The meeting is being videotaped for distribution to the community television stations in North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items of the official agenda as well as items that are not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair and that all parties, including members of the RMLD Board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. So, lest I forget, wish all of our RMLD staff and all of our served community residents a very happy and joyous holiday season. And
hear, hear.
Same for your families. So we do not have a Citizens Advisory Board representation this evening, and we are also missing Phil Pacino, who was called on a special assignment at work, so he was unable to join us. So he also extends his well wishes for the holiday season, asked me to convey that. Dave Hennessy, will you please be our board secretary?
Absolutely.
Great. Okay. So we also have here this evening Peter Lidecker from FinCom, so thank you for joining us again. So I don't think we have anyone else who needs or wants to be acknowledged. So let us begin then with some committee updates, starting with the Policy Committee. Commissioner Hennessy?
Yeah, we had an adjustment to policy number 4 on smoking. That was just a minor edit on that. And then we also had a adjustment to the policy on procurement. There was an advancement in the dollar value from $25,000 to $50,000 before needing extra signatures and requirements to have us vote on.
Okay. Good. Any other policy issues?
No.
Concerns? Okay. Good. Okay. Next, as we need to do each year, I want to talk about the General Manager Committee meeting and the recommendations that came out of that. So let me just take a moment. This isn't concerning our General Manager Colleen O'Brien's performance review and recommendations for salary increase. So just for those who don't remember or aren't aware, just a little bit of background on the process. So the Board of Commissioners here at RMLD is responsible for hiring and evaluating the General Manager, setting compensation and establishing policies that guide the operations. So that's in accordance with Chapter 164 of our Mass General Laws. There's 7 criteria that the board members are asked individually to evaluate based on the performance year of July 15th to June 30th. They have relative weightings for each of them. So the categories are finance, which is 20% of the total, energy efficiency and load management at 15%, safe system reliability 20%, leadership 20%, board relations 5%, and then employee safety and relations 10%, and finally community relations 10%. So each board member is required to submit the evaluation, and then we meet and review as a subcommittee, which includes myself, Dave Talbot, and John Stempeck, and we review the feedback and come up with, based on the weightings, a recommended increase. So the I'd like to just summarize the feedback, then I'll explain the calculation and the recommendation for approval. So there was a lot of positive news to report, some of which you've heard presented in previous meetings, but I'd like to just highlight some areas. So for the fiscal year under consideration, we had no audit findings, which we reported at the last board meeting, so that is certainly a positive reflection of Colleen's management and her staff. Under leadership and employee development, I think we've covered this in the last several meetings, a lot of significant positive work under employee development and staff development, organizational changes, succession planning, and really, which I believe is the role of the leader here at RMLD, making sure we have the right people in the right positions, which is kind of job one. Also, many of you know we've had a reliability study and organizational study, both of which had significant recommendations, and pleased to say all of which have been at least year-to-date recommended and implemented as appropriate. There's been a heavy focus this past year on rebuilding the infrastructure, improved maintenance, also the quality of service and productivity here at the RMLD has been positively affected. Renewable energy plans have been discussed and several implemented. Also, a responsiveness really to all the constituents. So Colleen has a large number of people with whom she's responsible to report, including the commissioners here, but also the town, the Citizens Advisory Board, industry groups, and so forth, union organizations. And when I say town, it's our served community, so Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. There's also been significant work done in process improvements and automation. We have terms and conditions that were reported about recently, a new handbook, and a lot of work on the geographic information system. Although it's not appropriate in this meeting due to time constraints, in her self-assessment, which is part of the process, Colleen has itemized about $1.7, almost $1.8 million of savings, $800,000 or so, which are actually hard savings in addition to soft savings in terms of, cost avoidance. So that's just a brief summary. So I think before we proceed with the recommendation, if any of the board members have to comment, I would say in summary, as the board chair, I think it's been an excellent year for Colleen. I think any four or five of those would be significant performance review items, but all of these were done. And as I like to say, the job is running the railroad and serving what is the largest, utility here and in our area, and she does it very well and extremely cost effective, as evidenced by our rates, which I think are second to none. So does any of the other commissioners want to add anything?
I think I'd just like to add to that. I think Colleen has done and continues to perform at an extremely high level, and has done an excellent job, not just this year, but ever since we have brought her into the RMLD. And we all certainly hope that continues into additional years moving forward, and we see no reason why it shouldn't.
I'd pile on there just to say that, I mean, if anybody, I don't know who watches the meetings, but if you do, there's a lot of fundamental infrastructure out there that needed a lot of attention, and that attention is being paid, and the level of engineering attention and detail is second to none, and it's really great to see. And the number of things that have been fixed and avoided that are hard to see that's just one area, but it's fundamental, and just so many great things have happened, and a lot of great things are underway. So I'm very pleased to be here and very pleased about everything, and just wanted to add that.
And Mr.
Yes,
I am. One thing that really is a testament to Colleen's leadership is how empowered and effective and engaged her employees are. And I think you see that with all the people that we interact with and we see presenting to us. And so that's a real compliment to her and her leadership. So echoing something you've already said.
Good. Thank you, colleagues. So the As I mentioned, each commissioner submitted their scores. The total score is 100. If you score, I gave you earlier the articulation of the different categories and the weightings. So basically, it's, by formula, we calculate each commissioner's rating and average. And so for Colleen, for the performance year, the average was 98.7. So not perfect, but pretty close to it. So based on our formula for calculating the general manager's increase, there's two pieces to it. The first piece is based on that composite score, and anything greater than 95 provides the opportunity for a 2% plus CPI, which totals 2.6% increase. So part of the review is 2.6 based on the score from the performance evaluation. The board also has the opportunity to consider an additional increase based on extraordinary performance, which I believe is based on the feedback from all the commissioners. I think we all unanimously agree is in that category, and that is left to the discretion of the board. So what we did, in addition to evaluating performance, we also sought some benchmark data, because as with any privately held company or public company, we need to be competitive in the industry we serve. So there's a meme survey which is conducted for, so we look at the particular industry that Colleen operates under. And in the utility area, we looked at the sizing of the utilities and also the revenue size, because that obviously impacts the load of work. So what we discovered is that Colleen's, although managing the largest size utility in the area, she's not at the highest level of compensation relative to others that are close to that size, but smaller. So based on that, and this doesn't put her at or above the others under consideration, but to keep at least within a competitive range, the board is recommending an additional 2.4% under the extraordinary performance category. So 2.6 for the calculation of the performance review, and under the category of additional performance, extraordinary performance, 2.4. So a total increase of 6%, and that is retroactive to July 1st, since that's the performance review cycle. The second element I want to discuss, and then we'll call for a discussion and vote. In addition, the employees here at RMLD are now eligible for an increase to ICMA, which is basically their retirement fund, a match. Is it a match contribution, Colleen? So, which currently has been 3%, but going forward is going to be 4%. So as general manager, but also employee of RMLD, Colleen should be eligible for that as well. So we're recommending, in addition to the 6% salary increase effective July 1, that we also increase the retirement contribution from 3% to 4%. So questions, comments from the board, or I guess Colleen also give you an opportunity to chip in and say anything that you'd like to say in terms of the performance review or the past year.
Well, I actually enjoy the review. It gives the opportunity to have some discussions, make sure I'm in line with what it is that you are expecting. That when that goes well, it seems like you know, I heard you correctly, and then we proceeded correctly. So that's always a good thing.
Yep.
I need to thank my staff though, because can't do this alone.
Yep.
And it's as we've gone through a lot of organizational changes, and as more people come on board with, you know, the change is hard, and transitioning from reactive to proactive, and moving the ship in a to meet the challenges of the future with solar and other things of that nature. I'm glad to have at least these three sitting here. we seem to work really well in a kind of a think tank type way, which as an engineer I appreciate, and we've made a lot of changes, and you know, it's nice. People call us on the phone, they want to know what we're doing, so I feel like we're back in a leader position where we should be, being one of the largest utilities, and it's nice when people come to us and say, what are you guys doing, how you doing, how you making it out, and it's a good compliment, I think, for everyone. And but thank you for the assessment and feedback, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
Good. You're welcome. Other comments from?
I think you stated it very well.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you enjoy the review. There's a saying that performance reviews are one of those unique human encounters where employees get no sleep the night before, and managers get no sleep the night before, and employees get no sleep the night after. But when you do a good job, that's the exception.
Can I say one more thing? Because I didn't.
No, I'm sorry. You can't.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
These two. Couldn't do it without these two. They're as exceptional in their support of the RMLD and of me, of all of the managers, and you know, Tracy's fairly new, but she hit the ground running.
Yep.
And it's really their.
I think the board heartily concurs.
Absolutely.
Tracy,
yeah.
Right.
What about Peter? Though he didn't get any. Didn't Peter get some shout out here? What did?
Yeah,
thank you, Peter, for.
Yeah,
I mean, you're here. I mean,
thank you, Peter, for coming.
Yeah.
Good. Well, thank you, Colleen, for those. So.
Just a quick question.
Yes.
From the public viewing, could you redo that map? Just because the 2.4 and the 2.6.
Yep.
I just don't want the public to. I want to make sure that you're under the same.
Oh, how it added up.
Correct.
Oh, to the 6. Yeah, it has to be 6.
Yep. Yep. Maybe I.
I think it was 3.6, right?
One of the ratings.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, I did.
Thank you.
My writing.
the rates person.
Yeah.
Immediately. Yes.
I want to see if you were paying attention,
yeah.
Jane.
It goes down, Jane.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I just wanted to correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a very good point. Yes.
Well, what I'll do, because we should do that, I'll just summarize, and then I'll ask if one of the commissioners could. Propose a vote, okay? So, to summarize, we're recommending that Colleen O'Brien's salary be increased by 6%, which is made up of two components. First is 2% plus 0.6 CPI for a total of 2.6 based on the scoring of the evaluation by the commissioners, and an additional 3.4, the total of which is 6%. For a total salary increase effective July 1. And then secondly, to put in line with the rest of the employees here at RMLD, an increase from 3% to 4% contribution for the ICMA retirement fund. Okay, we have a motion?
Sure, I'd like to make a motion that, do you want to do it?
No, you can continue.
I'd like to make a motion that the general manager's salary be increased in aggregate by 6% per the division that you have between the two different components.
Okay, and do we want to, can we include the, and the?
Oh, and the
retirement
of 4% as well.
Okay. And just as a summary in the motion, the increase, salary increase being retroactive to?
I'm sorry, the salary increase also to be retroactive to July of 2016.
Right. Okay, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, none appearing. We'll have a vote. Those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
Aye. So a motion carries 401?
No,
or do we just 400? We don't have to count
we
for
that. We need to make motions on both policies if you don't
mind. On the policy
changes. Oh, okay. I didn't know if that was coming later. Okay. Yep. Yep.
Okay. So I have to I have to read that.
Yeah. Do we have? Are they covered? Trying to read.
Oh, no, you have to say.
Yeah. Just.
Oh.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. So I put the motion that the RMLD approves the modifications to policy number 4, revision number 6, on smoking.
And do you want to do the other one as well? We'll do one.
And do them both at the same time?
Yep.
And policy number 9, procurement, revision number 5.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? None appearing. We'll go for a vote. Those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay, motion carries 4-0. Okay, thank you very much. And again, Colleen, thank you for a good year. Just as a reminder, the other piece of work is also during the course of the year is continuing to review the new goals, which we'll do, and we also, which we'll talk about a little later, be scheduling a strategic meeting early in 2017 to look at progress in that area. Okay, so we have an approval of board minutes for this. So we have a
so moved.
Yep.
Let me just read it.
Yep.
move for the approval of the board minutes of May 12th, 2016.
Okay.
16.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay, none appearing. We'll take a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Right.
Aye. The motion carries 4-0. Okay. Do we have a report on the RMLD attendance at the CAB meeting for December 14th? Did we have
it? It was supposed to be Bill.
Yeah.
And ended up not being able to make it.
Oh, right. Okay. Okay. So we'll move forward then. Thank you. Okay. Colleen, your turn for the general manager's report.
Yes. Thank you. I've recently completed all 4 towns, meeting with each of the town managers. We had somewhat of about a 15-slide presentation. Most of the comments with the town managers were on double poles, explaining the new engines process of ball and court. We talked about the LED streetlight program. We're halfway done. It's about 8,000 lights, and we have 4,000 LED lights up so far. No comments, really. It's been a very successful program, so we continue with that. We touched on all of the highlights, as you've mentioned some of them, Tom, in the review. They're in the annual report, so we kind of went through them. Talked about the new service requirements handbook, the change in the terms and conditions. We did mention a preliminary rate increase of between 2% and 4%. But as I had committed, every 3 years we would do a formal cost of service study, so that would be this year. So we did one the first year I came, and so a little later we're going to talk about the budget, but we're going to try to do the cost of service study so it can roll right into the budget process so that we can announce any changes at that time. But right now, we like when I meet with the town managers and the selectmen, I like to give them some kind of preliminary figures so they can segue into their budget process as well. There wasn't a lot of questions in any of the towns. I did ask Reading and North Reading, who have vacancies on the CAB. While I do not have the people's names, there are one from each town that are going to be processed through and should be active on the CAB the first of the year.
Great.
So probably nice. Getting on selectmen agendas towards the end of this month. So that was really the highlights of the discussions. And then this past Monday night, I had my first selectmen meeting. So after I meet with the town managers, then we go into a selectmen process. And so we met Monday night in Linfield. Same, you know, it's kind of a dry run with the town manager and, you know, more detailed discussions. And then we take the slideshow to the selectmen. So that went well. There wasn't really any questions or anything. I think they liked the presentation. We did talk a little bit about solar, and Jane was able to get some paperwork in on the results of that Volkswagen class action, so that perhaps maybe we'll have some funding for the charging stations for electric vehicles that will go in the homes. So we'll be getting some feedback on that and coming up with a program there. We have in last year's budget to put electrical vehicle charging stations, one in each town. We're looking at this parking lot out here right now just because the surface is so uneven and water is collecting, so we're probably going to resurface that and possibly put a charging station in there. There are some other grant monies that may help with some leasing programs of vehicles, as we have some vehicles coming up for turnover. So we're making a lot of headway in that area, and that, you know, those will be sales that come in from the charging stations.
Nice, I'm glad there's gonna be one here that's a nice
it'll be good.
Advertisement.
Yeah, so we'll probably send out for a design for the parking lot, because it, you know, it has to go through the town, it's gonna be a site plan.
Yep.
And then, you know, designing the charging stations and hopefully get it in the spring when the asphalt plants come back up, so.
Would that be for public use?
For public use.
How many, any idea how many there'd be, or?
Probably one or two. Level two charging stations, possibly level three, we have to look into that a little bit more. But yeah, so you can go to the app, like PlugShare or something, and find out what's available and.
That would be great.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember, we actually have one at our company that was put in when they did a rebuild. It looks like, is there two charges to each unit, or am I missing?
Most of them are dual operated.
Yeah.
So it's like a gas pump that has
two
on it.
Yeah, that's what I thought, yeah, so that's good. Okay, anything else, Colleen?
Nope, that was the highlights of the discussion. There was, you know, no adverse comments. Everybody was happy with what's going on, and.
Yeah, as I mentioned in our discussions earlier on your review, you know, I think it's good, but also extremely time-consuming, I know, to reach out to all the constituents, because we obviously here in Reading and serve Reading, but there's three other communities, and that really, when you add Reading, so it's 4X when you have to bring something to the Citizens Advisory, but also meet with the selectmen and or whatever the unit of government is there, and so forth, so it's multiplicative. So we appreciate doing that, and I think based on the CAB feedback, I think they always feel like they're kept up to date, which is good.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, may I just
just
to add to that I was at the present I was present at the meeting with Bob Lelisher, the town manager of Reading, and just broached the topic of it's a very busy time for the town of Reading right now, but just broached the topic of you know, moving forward with solar on town property, town buildings. And he expressed at least a conceptual, I don't speak for him obviously, but a conceptual interest in knowing what the numbers would be. And I'm sure that RMLD is prepared to help with any estimation and RFPs in that direction, should we get an indication from the town, at town bodies, that they would like us to do that. Of course, we don't own the building, so we can't go ahead without some kind of approval. But conceptually, there's green generation and a revenue stream. It needs to be vetted out, but we're ready to do that if we're authorized to do so.
Good. Colleen, did you say everything you needed to with respect to budget process?
I had a couple. The budget process, quickly, we had our first kickoff meeting on December 6th. We had another kickoff meeting. If you can have two kickoff meetings on the 12th. And we're using the same format with the 6-year on the capital. The expense, we're probably going to unbundle a little bit. A little bit more detail on that, just because of the amount of maintenance that we've been doing, amount of training that we've been doing. So we want to be able to break that out. You know, the auditor did say what a great transition we made with Barb retiring and Wendy coming on board. So she's trying to consolidate some of the financials so that they're easy to go through. I mean, there's a lot that's produced for reporting, but at the same time, there's stuff that we need internally. So we're trying to consolidate that so that we're all looking at the same type of financials. Right. So we're thinking that because it's a formal cost of service study this year, that by January 15th we'll have a fairly good draft that Jane can start to incorporate into a formal cost of service study. And if we can hit that target, as you recall, the final has to be out and in the CAB's hands by March 31st. So that's the schedule. And then it's two nights, one expense, one capital, and we can look at those dates as we come up. But if there's anything other changes in the process or the format from what you saw last year, I think you'll be pleased that there's a little bit more unbundling of some details. We're also shifting towards utilizing the FERC coding for utility accounting a little bit more, so that we all start to get used to what buckets we use within, you know, industry for the utility. We all use the same accounting system, so. Anyways, I have just a couple of little.
Yeah, I just wanted to, just so we don't miss it, I think one of the processes that we've implemented recently, certainly for last year's, was, since it spans over two nights, is not approving both CapEx and the operating budget at the same time. So regardless of which one gets presented first, we approve the budget in total. And the reason for that is, if we approve the CapEx budget and then we get the operating budget and there's issues for whatever reason, we would rather having to unapprove if you can even do that.
Right.
So I think that seemed to work nicely.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, sure.
Just a couple of quick community. The RMLD historical calendar is out. Many may have seen it. They are available, and you can also download one on the RMLD website. The Festival of Trees at Parker Middle School in Reading was held on Saturday, December 3rd, and Sunday, December 4th. The RMLD donated the tree, a tree, to this event. The Good Neighbor Energy Fund kickoff breakfast.
I did have to say, in a previous fundraiser, my wife and I had 100 free tickets, and we didn't win a tree. So I guess that means there's a lot of other people contributing, which is good.
Good.
But the tree did look good. It was very competitive.
Yeah. The Good Neighbor Energy Fund kickoff breakfast is being held on Tuesday, January 11th. The RMLD will have a representative at this meeting. The art contest award ceremonies, the judging is taking place now. We're hoping to have most of the judging done by tomorrow. The award ceremonies will take place on Thursday, January 12th, and Thursday, January 19th at 7 p.m. I'll let Jane explain this, because we're saving money by migrating away from the t-shirt contest and going into this, watercolor contest, and recycling the frames that are in here so that we can, you know, mat their artwork. But we're giving a lot more prizes. So we saved a lot of money, but we took some of the money we saved in order to give more prizes out. Mm-hmm. So more art rooms will get the $200 award, and more children will get the Barnes & Nobles. But that's why we need to have it on two nights. So Jane, if you can.
Right, there's 12 schools participating and three winners at each school. So in essence, we'll have 36 winners as opposed to 12, which we had last year. So we're tripling the number of winners, and so it'd be difficult to incorporate that in one evening in the cafeteria because of space constraints. So we've decided to split it six and six, so that we could accommodate families and the students,
right,
as well as the administration.
And certainly all the commissioners are invited, just as every year, but if you would like to split in half and just have to do one night to come in to take some photographs, I'm sure the parents and the children will appreciate that. Jane and I will be there both nights, and but I think it's going to be better. There's going to be more prizes, more
kids
excited.
Yeah, that sounds like a great idea.
And it's a good thing.
What are the dates again?
January 12th and January 19th, two Thursdays, 7 p.m.
Colleen, I think I know the answer to this. So in the past, we've sometimes had the home lighting contest or whatever. Is that scheduled for this year, or are we not doing that this year?
Because of the vacancy of the community manager position, we've taken a year sabbatical, but hope to reinstate that next year.
Good.
And the same thing with the trains. The former retiree who had set up the trains had some medical issues this current year, so we're taking a year off and then hope to reinstate that as well next year.
Good. Thank you.
I have a question, Mr.
Yes,
Chairman.
Yes, go ahead.
On the cost of service, so when you redo the rates, I'm wondering, is there a way for us to think about how the rates can be tweaked in ways that aid our demand reduction goals? If I'm not mistaken, there's a residential rate, and if you consume even more electricity than the normal amount, your rate actually goes down. Am I mistaken about that?
you actually pay less per kilowatt hour if you consume more electricity, or am I getting that wrong? One of the residential rates, like, it's up to a certain amount, but if you are a very mega consumer, am I wrong?
No, that's incorrect, because they're all based on kilowatt hours.
Right.
On the commercial side, that could be the case depending on the demand component and the energy component.
Okay.
But on the residential side,
then I'm thinking,
other than the customer charge, every component is per kilowatt hour.
And it doesn't, there's nothing scaled to a certain, so it's the commercial rate that I'm thinking of.
I believe that's correct.
And there's a commercial rate where if you're above a certain amount, it gets even less. Is that tailored for a few big customers then?
Yeah, we don't have step rates that you're referring to. Some utilities have what you're referring to, where the first block of energy is priced at one level, and then the next block would be priced at maybe a lower or higher level.
None of our rates do that?
None of our rates do that.
Okay. Well, good work. Keep it up. Is there a way?
She's saying she's implemented your suggestion.
Thank you. I appreciate it. So I'm ahead of my time or something.
Again.
But is there a way to, in the general spirit of the question, because there's many rates, it's confusing. Is there a way to tweak them in a way that you could implement something where if you consume above a certain amount, you're going to get a little bit of a higher rate to incentivize the demand reduction that we seek, you know, during peak times? Because, I mean, pricing is a very powerful tool in general to achieve goals. So it's a big question, but it's never been looked at in that way, I don't think, before, other than having a time-of-use rate that a few people use. We don't really do this at all.
Yeah,
right?
It's just that if you're using electricity with a time-of-use rate, you know, you are paying more during the peak period.
Correct.
So
I'm saying, but that's a very small minority of users that actually does that, that has that program. I being one of them.
If there's other utilities that have that type of usage, you're talking about just during peak.
Well, stepping back, I think there might be 400 people. It's 29,000 customers.
Yeah.
And how many people have a time of use meter? Like a few hundred.
Correct.
So it's almost nobody is actually paying different amounts at different times a day, or based on this, or, and none are paying based on the scale of their use at all, correct?
The time of use has different rates for the time of day. And
I know,
so
but I'm saying almost nobody actually has opted into that rate.
There's a very few percentage of customers.
Right. So what I'm saying is that almost very, very few people use these things at all. Is there a way to tweak all of the rates to adjust toward the behavior that we want, which is to cut those peak megawatts, which are going to save us 200,000 per megawatt?
You would actually, I'm based on what I think you're saying,
yep,
is you would need a time of use meter, like a real-time meter, so that you program the meter to say, you know, if you use any electricity you use between, you know, say 2 and 7 on a peak day that we call,
yep,
that's going to be a premium rate, and you would program the meter to do that.
At least for your big customers.
Yeah, so. I'm not sure how, we'd have to think about how you could design a rate like that, because we'd want it around peak, right?
Right. I mean, I would just like us to try to move in that direction. There are some utilities that do this now. I know it's hard, and it's a smart grid thing that we don't really have, but.
Yeah, and there's definitely political discretions that will have to be made based on that, because typically when you have a cost of service done and you look at your existing rates and then your proposed rates,
right,
and typically commissions don't want to see huge swings for rate classes of customers, because that's significant rate increases or rate decreases, because you're recovering a pool of monies,
right?
And so there may be a strategy that as a board that you might want to develop so that you gradually get to a position,
right,
that you're talking about. And so we can definitely have those discussions as we're going through the course of service with the hope of that real-time pricing, which,
right,
is down the road someday, that people will actually pay the cost that it's actually costing to generate that time.
And one baby step in that direction could be that the big commercial customers are going to be told that rates are changing slightly. We're going to, like, instead of a flat increase of 2%, say, is going to be no increase from 8 p.m. to noon, nothing, but a 4% increase from noon to 8 or something like that. So they get the same. If they tweak their behavior, they'll either pay nothing more or they might even save. But the incentive will be there.
Yeah, I think we have to be very careful. We have to look at it on a case by case basis,
right?
Because when you're developing integrated circuits like Analog Devices,
sure,
does, you can't just turn them on and turn them off.
Well, no,
for
but
an hour period.
Right.
I mean, it takes many days worth of,
sure,
very high wattage for those quartz tubes to be able to accomplish what they do. So
and they're running overnight too.
Absolutely.
So they'd
absolutely
save overnight under what I'm saying.
Right. You can't just turn them on and turn them off.
No, I know. No, I know. But I mean, for somebody who's using round the clock energy, they might save money if we didn't raise the rates for 20 hours a day, but did raise them extra for 4 hours a day.
Maybe.
That's all.
How much increase the rates?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So anyway, I would just like to start thinking like this.
Absolutely. Yeah, we can
I mean,
definitely look at that. We just, I want to be cautious. We have, you know, customers that, you know, we have helped them in conservation measures,
right,
significantly to the point where there's not much left to conserve.
Right.
And, you know, short of tearing the building down and starting from scratch with the best efficient motors or compressors. And even though they are, you know, now have all of these rebates and measures implemented, their corporate is saying, we want electric cut. And, you know, if
the costs, their costs, right.
And if capacity and transmission is continuing to go up in the Boston area, in this area, you know, and they've already implemented all of these efficiency measures, let you figure out what typically happens with that.
Well, not to belabor it, but I could see how a company could benefit under conceptually what I'm talking about.
I think we ought to hold this in a different meeting,
sure,
maybe even a strategy,
yeah,
meeting.
Because I agree.
You know, we've talked in the past about the fact that if we can keep the rates very low, it could be an economic incentive,
exactly,
for bringing businesses into the area.
Exactly.
We all want that.
We do.
Yeah. Okay, good suggestion.
So it'll be part of our strategy,
yeah,
meeting.
Yep. Okay, good. Good discussion. Jane, are you ready to come up and do,
yeah,
a power presentation?
Can I do it from here, or would you prefer me to sit there?
Your choice. As long as...
my voice?
Yes, yes. As long as you...
I just have 6 quick slides, 3 for September and 3 for October.
Can you guys see? You want me to try to get these lights down a little bit?
There you go. You turn the lights out.
Yeah, maybe dim the lights a little.
Yeah, dim a little bit if you can.
Put up the music.
Is that working?
There's energy efficiency in action.
That's right.
Yeah.
Here we go. We're saving
Perfect.
Already. Okay, Jane.
Okay, this first graph looks at capacity costs. We've talked a lot about that in terms of the trend, and the trend is definitely increasing. If we look back at the cents per kilowatt hour that RMLD is paying in capacity, we're looking over the 5-year period, 2012 to 2016, around $10.11 per kilowatt a month in 2012, and that's up to $13.9 per kilowatt month. Our requirement is actually increasing as well. If you look at 15, our requirement was just shy of 225, and right now our requirement per month is in excess of 230 megawatts that we have to maintain for the entire year, capacity year. The next slide looks at transmission. It's the same trend, and it's going up. This is these costs are socialized throughout New England. There's been over $9 billion invested in transmission infrastructure, and all the constituencies throughout the New England region are paying for this. So we started paying about 9.7 million, and it's up to about 15.4. So those are significant increases. They're a pass-through. It's part of power supply. So we try to structure our programs to try to minimize that as a way to manage those costs. But everybody in New England is paying these costs. The purchase kilowatt hours and the embedded cost for the month of September, again, looking at that 5-year average. For the month of September, we actually purchased less kilowatt hours. So this kind of continues with our sales decreasing compared to 2015, as well as the actual cost of that. So it started around 4.5 cents back in 2012, and it's about 4.8 cents. So the cost is kind kind of levelized, and that has a lot to do with the natural gas plus our contracts that we're able to secure. Just the amount that we're purchasing is less because our sales are decreasing as well. Going to the month of October, one of the things that we do here at RMLD, which is helpful to our customers, is we try to stabilize the fuel charge. We don't want to have a high volatility of up and down trying to recover those costs. So we have a deferred fuel cash reserve that we use when we overcollect and undercollect, and that helps us to stabilize the cost. So as this slide indicates, over May 2015 to October 2016, that fuel charge is leveled approximately at 5 cents. And that is a direct cost to the customer. So over the last, if we looked historically, that's been pretty level and down. So even though capacity and transmission, we're getting a slightly lower energy cost, which is helping all of our constituents. The next slide looks as back in 2014, Colleen, and when we did our first cost of service, we unbundled it. So we have purchase power, capacity, and transmission as one component of the purchase power, and then the fuel charge. So this is the second, the capacity and transmission. And again, that's a level charge. What happens, though, is it's really directed to the amount of sales we have every year. So depending on what the sales are doing, in the last months of the fiscal year, which is usually March, April, and May, where we see that little increase in there. If sales are decreasing and we're tracking how our capacity and transmission, which is fairly stable from a budget standpoint, and those kilowatt hours are decreasing, we have to ramp that rate up to recover that. And so historically, those tend to go a little over 5 cents, but the combination of the two of them is pretty level. And again, that's one of the directives that the board has set in terms of eliminating the volatility in order for customers to be able to budget their bills and understand what they're going to be paying. And then the last component on a residential bill is their NYPA credit. So this is just a credit that the residentials receive. It's a per kilowatt hour credit. This goes up and down, and it's based on the replacement cost of that power. So it's been as high as just under 0.008, and it's really averaging around 0.00 between 4 and 6. And so that goes just to our residential customers. And that completes my report.
Any questions from the board?
Good. Okay. Good. Thank you, Jane. Hamid, you're up.
Thank you.
Would you like to stay there too?
Oh, but if you want me to.
Wherever you're comfortable.
That's fine. Great, thank you. The first slide.
I don't know, let me just, from a broadcast point of view, is it.
Can you hear me?
Well.
You want me to sit there?
Yeah, maybe. I didn't think of that. Yep.
You're not as loud as Jane.
Oh.
Well, it's we want to get the profile too.
Yeah,
I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. Good evening.
Good evening.
My report starts with my capital improvement project, basically under the capital improvement projects. We got the list of the projects that you see. I'm glad to report that we're making good progress on all of those categories. As you see, the spending is keep going up, which means good. That's going to increase the plant value. So the year-to-date total by October 31st was $260,503 on those capital projects. The next slide is a routine constructions, and you see a list of projects that fall under that category, and that brings the year-to-date to $619,818. And we getting good chunk of those taken care of, and again, the progress on those are great, really great. I'm happy about that. The next slide shows the routine maintenance. These are listed maintenance programs that we have established, and we're making good progress on those for transformer replacement through October to 2016. Approximately 23% of Piedmont transformers are replaced from the list of originally identified 3,600 transformers that they're aging, and we're gonna have to upgrade or replace them. Overhead transformers, 15% approximately been replaced, and we making good progress on those. These are the transformers that, you know, you've been, you know, they potentially they could have leaked, and we caught them basically before they we spend the money on, you know, the maintenance.
Excuse me, Hamid, if I could ask just a question.
Sure.
Do we get more efficiency out of the new transformers?
Yes. Under the new guideline of the Department of Energy, you know, the new transformer purchase, they should be 99% efficient. And that's in our bid specifications. That when they go out, they're mandated manufacturers to give us the
that's
transformers
great.
That 99% efficient.
More of the power actually.
And
gets
we
to
request
their own,
and we request the test reports to just to verify them, every single one of them, to make sure, you know, they meet the requirements.
You.
By all means. Under the pole inspections, the end of October, we have 194 poles that have been replaced, and 112 of those they've been transferred. So you see that as we're making all these improvements and reconstruction of the system and upgrading them, we are making every attempt trying to do the transfers as fast as we can, and taking care of those. The visual inspection of overhead lines, you could see the list of those circuits that, you know, every quarter. My crews, our crews, they patrolling the lines to see if any obvious signs of wear and tears or, you know, deterioration of or degradation of the materials, and we take care of them right away if we see any sign for reliability reasons. The manhole inspection, we started this program last year, and so far out of the 1237, we have inspected 961. We take pictures, we document them on the GIS plant. And as we visit these, if there are any degradation or any attention maintenance work that needs to be done, we take care of them right away. And we've captured lots of those issues that could have potentially lead to a failure, and we stop them. The porcelain cutouts, 91% so far it's done, and we're making good progress on those. The tree trimming, the year to date, we've taken care of 375 spans, and we're making good progress on those. The substation maintenance, we infrared every month the substations, and every quarter we do the parks to make sure that the reliability is gonna stay at its highest level. And so far we haven't found any problems. The next slide, the double poles, you could see the ownership, there are approximately 16,000 poles throughout our service territories. The ownership is 50-50. Between the RMLD and Verizon. Custodial is split between the Reading, between RMLD and Verizon. North Reading is, the custodial is full with RMLD, and Linfield and Wilmington is with the Verizon. The next one is, this is my favorite program, which is actually is helping us to manage the double pole the situations in all four communities. In the town of Linfield, we got four transfers that we need to take care of, and we are taking care of that. North Reading, we got 15 transfers and 45 pole bots. The Reading, we got 48 transfers and 45 pole. And Wilmington, we got 46 transfers, one attachment, and four pole, and one guy that needs to be removed. One point I'd like to make, as we go on through these lots of your construction upgrades that they come in, I do really appreciate the our customers, our ratepayers, great ratepayers, patience with us. So as we're making these upgrades to increase the reliability, improve the efficiency of the system. So we making this is our highest priority, and we're making every attempt trying to take care of them as soon as possible. And the good thing about this program is that, you know, well, it automatically notifies the next party that they need to do the transfers. We're making every attempt trying to notify Comcast and Verizon to do those transfers, but we really don't have much, you know, power to say, especially Verizon. Verizon, they're trying to get out of the pole business. And right. It's getting slow, you know, the transfers and here, there. So, but we're doing everything we can trying to get them to move faster. So thank you for your patience. The next slide is the RMLD reliability indices. As you could see, we're doing well under those categories. They're all under the national average. We got few We got slightly a little bit above the regional average, and that's due to on for the SADE and SAFE, and that's due to the number of storms that we had and motor vehicle accidents that, you know, they made a huge damage, major damage to our main lines, and that's what caused really the this. I would like to take this opportunity and ask of residents, please be careful while you're driving out, especially during the winter time. It's a slippery, and you know, texting, driving, that's dangerous. Please stop. If you see anyone doing that, please advise them, because they could, you know, it could be fatal, and it could damage the Reading light infrastructure as well. So the next slide is showing the causes of the outages for annual average for 5 years, as well as year to date. As you see, the major categories are the equipment, trees, and the wildlife, which we are as we are making more improvements on those, and the maintenance, these numbers, they should go down. And that concludes my report. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer.
Just so around just sort of the investment in the infrastructure, so you went over the CapEx projects and routine construction.
Right.
The year-to-date cost, that's based on our fiscal July 1, right?
That's
our
right.
Calendar.
That is correct.
Just curious, if we continue at the rate you expect we might, what do you think for the fiscal year the total spend will be in terms of, you know?
But we budgeted approximately $9.5 million, and, you know, that's what the board approved.
Yeah.
And I'm anticipating close to, not $8 million, $8.5 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got the big, yeah, we got a DG project that it's going to be around 2.6, 2.7 million. That's a big one. That's going to go online June 1st.
Yeah.
And it's going very well. The project is on target. So we'd like to to put that in service before the next peak, which we're going to see the benefits, reduction of the capacity and transmission costs. To offset some of the charges, some of the increases that you're
going to
see.
No, I think it's instructive for all of our ratepayers, because it shows we're investing in.
We're hoping we can secure the land. Colin and I, we are negotiating with a couple of, you know, property owners for the new substation.
Yeah.
So,
right.
And if we get that going, that's, you know, big chunk of money.
Yep.
And lots of improvements we've made at substations that you don't see the cost. These numbers, they keep going up. Gradually, like substation four is completed.
Yeah.
Basically, five is going to be completed next month. Station three.
They're investments for the future.
Yeah, they're investments that they keep coming up, and I'm glad we're doing these. These are all the maintenance that they were due long time ago.
Yeah.
And you know, we continuously, as we identify those deficiencies, we are addressing them, and we have taken the system has come up a lot. You know, a lot of the areas that needed to be. Maintained. We're still not out of the woods yet.
Yep.
Because, you know, this is going to take a long time, like transformer replacements, lots of overhead services that they need to, they're degrading. We need to pay attention to those, especially the services, the connectors, you know, for overhead, underground, lots of underground areas that are still, it's old constructions, and we need to upgrade those. So, but we basically, with our maintenance program, we stopped the really critical ones. Like when I came on board, I was really nervous because we had few hairy situations that potential huge oil release that could have cost the utility close to $200,000 to $250,000 probably each.
Yeah.
And what we did, we stopped those by, you know, implementing this program as well as, you know, expediting that the program in order to catch them before they fail. And but
well, I'm really glad to see this, especially in light of 0 degree temperatures and 50 mile per hour winds that we're experiencing. It's nice to see that we've got some reliability built into the system.
That's right.
And it's going to get better. It's definitely going to get better day by day.
Yeah, no, clearly so. And it is all about reliability.
We caught it right on the edge of basically major failure, if you want to call it.
Right.
But it's getting better.
Good. Thanks, Amit. Any other questions from the commissioners? Okay. Thanks, Amit.
Thank you so much.
Wendy.
The bids?
Do you want to do them now? Or?
Oh,
yeah. Okay, John, here's the... Yeah. Let's see.
Here we go. Move the proposal 2017-27 for single-phase pad-mounted FR3 transformers be awarded to Wesco for $151,110 pursuant to Chapter 164, Section 56D, on the recommendation of the general manager.
Do you have a
These are the...
You have a second?
Second.
Thank you. These are basically, this is supporting our underground maintenance program. As you know, we've been going through lots of those, lots of areas for upgrade, and we're buying these major, basically purchase of 70 transformers in order to continue that program. The FR3 transformers, these are the environmental friendly. Dave, you should be happy about that, right? Everybody. So this is the FR3, the vegetable oil, which is very safe. And, you know, if it's released to the environment, you know, it's not going to be...
Will that encourage the wildlife to attack it, though?
Definitely. Well, hopefully not. So we sent a bid out to 15 potential bidders. Four responded, and among those, the lowest responsible bidder was Wesco. And the rest, either they didn't meet the qualifications, like, you know, they two of them, they were subject to, they didn't accept our terms and conditions. That automatically, you know, they were disqualified, and one firm, one vendor submitted two price for the same transformers. You know, you can do that. You know, that's illegal, basically.
That's a military bid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's it. If you need any more explanation, I'd be more than happy to.
All right. Any discussion? Not appearing. We'll go vote.
Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries 4-0. John, do we have another one? I think we do. Yeah. Do we? Do you have other?
Yeah, no, that's it. That's it.
That's it.
Yeah, no, that's it. Yeah.
We have a second. Okay.
Thank you
no
so
more
much.
Money. Sorry, I mean.
I appreciate it. I'd like to take this opportunity to wish everybody a very Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays, and have a safe one.
You too.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
You.
Me, same to you and your family. Thank you. Thank you, John. Okay. Now, Wendy.
Okay. As Colleen mentioned, we are diligently working to try to kind of revamp these financials and maybe consolidate them, give a, I don't know, more efficient look, or we're trying to look at making our system efficient and add value to what we're looking at, let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of work involved, so I apologize, there are no slides tonight. I'm just gonna go over what the first quarter of FY17 is showing us, okay?
Okay.
So if you look at page one, so you might notice there are some missing pages because that's all part of the process and I just haven't renumbered them. If you look at page one, currently we have a strong financial position. Our cash balances are solid. Which basically means, in case there's any question on that, it means that if our accounts receivable collections decrease for any reason, or our payables increase, any kind of cost increase, that we're feeling like we can handle the swing. So that's basically what that's showing us. And then if you look at our receivables, right now we're about 95% current, which is really good. It says something for our collections department. We're doing a really good job bringing in and our customers really want to just pay, which is really a good thing. And then if you turn to page two, and you look at our capital assets, we've increased about $3 million in our net capital assets. And this is in part due to the continuing efforts to provide a safe and reliable infrastructure with our ongoing capital projects. If you turn to page three, you can see that currently our PPCT and fuel revenues exceed our PPCT and fuel expenses by about $1.1 million, which puts us at an overall revenue increase compared to the prior year of about 3%. Base revenues are up about 12.7%, and operating and maintenance expenses are also up around 12.9%, which shows a consistent, flat, but stable picture of the financials, as we've been stating all along. Operating and maintenance expenses on the last page, I'm sorry, I told you there was an error there, so the last page on your screen is not correct, the one in front of you is. The budget to actual, the operating and maintenance expenses are under budget by about $500,000, and that's due in part to the labor contracts, the retro pay that we have to calculate, and the vacancies that we have, and then, of course, there's the timing of the payables. Some costs didn't, maybe didn't make it in the right month. That concludes my report.
Anything that we should be thinking about with respect to the financials, Wendy? It sounds like we're in strong position.
We're in a strong position right now. I mean, we've been talking about possibly thinking about bonding for the land, but we're not there yet. So, you know, there's nothing we can do until we secure it.
Right.
But
good. Any other?
Yeah, Wendy. Why did the cash? You might have said this. I missed it. The unrestricted cash has gone up $5 million+ from year to year. What is the driver of that?
Well, it could, I mean, I can look at the trend and see what the reason is in particular, but it just could be a matter of our receivables and the timing of what month, as far as how much we've billed out in one month to the next, or it, I can look into it.
Just curious, it's a big number, a big change.
Right.
You
know? The accrued liabilities, I'm sorry, what did you say?
They went up by about $6 million. So
that that's because of our net pension, our unfunded pension liability?
That's not a short-term liability.
No, right, exactly.
Okay. Well, why don't we look into it for next meeting? I think.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Sure.
And it is like a checkbook, so it's just a snapshot. Depending on
so it's just a time of day,
right.
Your time,
like
your time of month.
All the bills are getting paid out, and your salaries, everything's coming out of that.
Yes, that's exactly right.
So it's like you're taking a snapshot of your checkbook, and then
in that moment in time,
and then bills go out. And
I mean, we have all the retro pays we're going to have to be calculating. That's going to have a change, and exactly what Colleen's saying.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the timing of the payables and the receivables together combined
cause the changes.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Right, we'll check into it anyway. See
yes, sure. No problem.
Anything. That's good. Anything else, Wendy?
No, I think that's good for now.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. We have some meetings to discuss. Board meetings are two that was already mentioned, January 12th and the 19th for the Art Award Ceremony.
Mm-hmm.
Then on Thursday, January 26th, we'll have our January board meeting, and Thursday, February 23rd, for the February meeting. Colleen, I don't know if we want to maybe have something looked at offline, but we did talk about having to have this strategic meeting, which is really, maybe you want to, because I think it came out of some conversation recently. Do you want to just give a brief idea of what you envision, for the commissioners on that, for that type of meeting on the street? I know one thing we talked about is looking at the 20-year, plan and, what's in store for our system, some long-term thinking, but is there other pieces you want to briefly describe
the,
that you would...
The rolling 20-year plan, yeah.
The concept of why I was asking for the meeting is that... technology is changing very quickly as it impacts the electric industry, solar. There's a lot of impacts on a utility that were never there before. For 100 years, technology changes, we're getting more, the efficiency in a transformer is getting better. You can now automate a cap bank. We really never had anything penetrate a franchise. This municipal utility is it provides a service and a benefit for all of the towns that it serves. It provides in lieu of tax payments and return on investments, and we're in the business of selling electricity. And so when that when you have things that can be eroding at that, we want to make sure that we have strategic plans going forward. And we talked earlier, we have our community solar program that's going on, and finding more rooftops and things like that will add to that, the benefit of that. Getting in on the electric vehicle charging stations. So you're balancing the good with the good. You know, Reading Light's good, and saving the planet's good. You know, it's the Superman and the Batman, you know, at each other. It's, you know, they're both good entities. And so I want an opportunity, since this is such a dramatic change, for Jane and I and Hamid to present to you the ideas going forward. I mean, I know we've talked about other types of revenue sources and businesses in the past, but we're all about efficiency right now, and we're trying to utilize the skill sets and the vehicles that we have now, first, to say these are the types of things that we're looking at, without having to increase staff, without having to buy different types of vehicles, and to go into different businesses. So I want an opportunity to present those, and possibly even have someone come in and talk about what they see is going to be happening in this area over the next 5 years, 10 years, and 15 years.
Good, and we can roll in the discussion we had earlier. So on the rates. So offline, I think we can float some dates out. But just is February the right time? January, we've got a board meeting plus the two.
Just have someone come in and talk by February, yeah.
Or you know, we have to nail it down, but just try to get a sense of when is.
Oh, I think that's a good time.
January doesn't look like a good month where we have the contest. Okay, why don't we take a look, and Gene, maybe you and Tracy can float some dates out, and we'll see what works for everybody. Good, thank you for that, Colleen. Okay, is there anything else, Gene, that we need to cover on the committee meetings still to be set up, and then get an update on the CAD meetings. So.
Quick question on scheduling.
Yes.
So if we're going to be, would we all be here for the art meetings? Maybe we could just have the strategy meeting and combine it so we're all going to be here anyway.
Well, I thought we're going to divide them up. We're going to do two, like a couple of us for one of them and a couple of us for the other.
Okay. Yeah, we might need to get a little more time to for probably would think for Colleen and Jane. Otherwise, that would have been a good idea. Okay.
I do like the morning meetings, I have to admit. I think they work well.
Yeah.
Because I think we think better in the morning.
Yes, I agree.
I like morning meetings, too.
Morning meetings.
I like them any time of day. as long as they're short.
Right.
Okay.
Meeting addict.
Yeah. Anything else, Colleen, Jean, Tracy, that we didn't do already? Again, thank you, everyone. All great to work yet to date, and Colleen, again, thank you and congratulations for a great year. And on behalf of the board, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. And John, you can
read the motion.
Have our motion to adjourn. Yep. Executive session.
Move that the board go into executive session to consider the purchase of real property and discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining. Chapter 164, Section 47D, exemption for competitively sensitive and other proprietary information provided in the course of proceedings conducted pursuant to this chapter when such municipal lighting plant board determines that such disclosure will adversely affect its ability to conduct business in relation to other entities making, selling, distributing, or distributing electric power and energy pursuant to this chapter, and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Not appearing. This is a roll call vote, so.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Okay, motion carries 4-0. Meeting adjourned.
Right.
Okay. Gene, should we bring in our tablets with us?
You want us to bring them over, Gene? Yeah.
Sure, yeah, we can take them over.
Yeah, I think the commissioners can handle that.
Carry this.